Hello, this is Anna Galletti, and we are going to talk now about part four of chapter one, our introduction orientation terminology, but we're going to focus in on covering membranes. And this is a little bit of a preview. We're going to go over covering membranes again after we get through the epithelial and connective tissues of our histology chapter. All right, so we need to talk more about the serous membranes, which are discussed in chapter one. But to do that, we really need to discuss what a covering membrane is. Basically, covering membrane and body membrane are two words for the same thing. So this is anatomy. And in anatomy, we are never happy unless we have at least three different ways to say the same thing. So we have a lot of synonyms and a lot of variations. And sometimes the synonyms mean exactly the same thing. And sometimes the synonyms are a matter of doing less specific description and a more specific description. But you're just gonna have to start getting used to it right now, having the most insane amount of synonyms and having to learn basically triple vocabulary. And it's just the way it is. So in the human body, we're going to be talking about three body membranes or covering membranes. Okay, now, what do they have in common? So number one, and this is important, this you memorize. They consist of a minimum of two tissue types. And you will remember that tissue types or when you've got basically the same group of cells working together to do the same thing. So epithelial tissue, connective tissue, nervous tissue, muscle tissue. Those are the four types. We'll talk more about that in a little bit when we do the histology chapter. But what you've got here for body membranes is a minimum of epithelium. And there are different types of epithelium, so we're just going to leave it a generic epithelium for now. And then you will always have connective tissue, and we can even make it more specific by saying it's going to be connective tissue proper, and it's almost always areolar connective tissue proper, but occasionally it might be reticular connective tissue proper. Maybe you'll throw in some dense, either fibrous or dense irregular or regular. We're just going to abbreviate that. I don't necessarily need you to memorize that right now, but just because when we do the histology chapter, I'm going to introduce more complexity to this explanation, and you'll be like, but she didn't say that the first week, but now I am. Okay, so these are the two things you need to remember for right now. Minimum of an epithelial layer and a connective tissue layer. This means these are a type of simple organ, because organs, when you have two plus tissues working together. Sorry, my handwriting is bad. I'll try to be a little bit neater as we go along. Not really, but I do try to think about it. Anyway, so of our body membranes, we have three types of body membranes. You have the mucosa. You have the serosa, and you have the cutaneous. Now again, it's anatomy. We need more than one way to say the exact same thing. So mucosa can also be called mucous membrane. Serosa can also be called serous membrane. And we don't really have another membrane name for cutaneous, but sometimes we call it the integument. Okay? Now, what do you need to know about these? Cutaneous is going to be your skin. Okay? Serous is going to be found only in the ventral body cavity, and it coats the outside of the organs and the walls of the cavity. These components are all important to the definition or explanation of what a serous membrane is. It's only in the ventral body cavity. You can't leave that out because we have other body cavities. It's only coating the outside. You can't say it's in organs because then it sounds like it's inside the interior, and that's not a serous membrane, that's a mucous membrane. So you got to put in outside, all right, outside of the organ, and then coating the walls of the cavity. Okay, now mucous membranes, I'm going to give you a special definition because the one in most textbooks is wrong. Okay, so this is important so that you do not do the wrong definition. Most books want to say that mucous membranes line tubes that open to the outside of the body. That's not accurate because blood vessels are lined with a mucous membrane, and if they open to the outside of the body, you will die. Okay? So the better definition is that they line the tubes of organs in the body. Okay? So they line the tubes of the organs within the body. So this could be like your stomach lining, or it could be a blood vessel lining. Okay? Now that we've got our basic definitions, we want to hone in on the serosa because we are talking about the ventral body cavity. So the ventral body cavity is lined with the serous membrane, okay? Now, what's interesting about the serous membrane is that it is a thin double layer, okay? And we can split the names of that into visceral, serosa, and parietal serosa. What does that all mean? Visceral means the organ. Parietal means wall. So this coats the outside of organs in the ventral body cavity. This coats the interior walls of the ventral body cavity. Okay? Now, between the two, there is what we call a potential space, which basically means they kind of touch each other, but there is a gap, and in that gap, there is serous fluid, right? And this is being secreted by the epithelium of the visceral serosa. And this serous fluid acts as kind of a lubricant. So I want you to visualize a slip and slide in your backyard. And your kid goes and runs onto the slip and slide, and there's no water on the slip and slide. And it's not fun. You stick to the slip and slide, you fall, you get hurt. But as soon as you put water on the slip and slide in your backyard, you slide across it, and it's a lot of fun. It's the same thing with a water park slide. The big ones, if you don't have water down them and you try to go on it with your bare skin and your bathing suit, you're going to stick and you're not going to slide, and it's going to be awful. All right, so the serous fluid prevents the visceral and parietal layers from sticking, right? It creates a nice smooth surface so that they move, because technically everything in the body is moving slightly. Some things are moving a lot, but everything is kind of moving against each other, and you don't want anything sticking. Now we're going to make it a little bit more complicated. We have three types of visceral and parietal serosa. Oh, sorry, my handwriting. The first one is what we call pericardium. All right, and I want you to focus on the name. Cardium means heart. So you will have visceral pericardium and you will have parietal pericardium. Okay, the visceral coats the outside of the heart, and when you study A&PI 2, you will find out that we also call it epicardium, because again, it's A&PI and we need multiple names for the same thing. The parietal pericardium forms what we call the pericardial sac, and it's a very dense membrane that basically the heart is kind of sitting within. All right, so that was the pericardium, and then we've got the pleura. And whenever you see the word pleura, you want to think lungs. And there is a visceral pleura, and there is a parietal pleura. Okay, this coats the lung. And the parietal pleura forms a sac that holds the lung. Okay. And then you've got peritoneum. And I'm getting tired of writing all that out, and you can see that I'm getting sloppy. So we're just going to say visceral peritoneum and parietal peritoneum. Okay. The visceral peritoneum, again, outside of abdominal organs. And parietal peritoneum is the walls. Okay. And I didn't say this before, but this is going to be in the abdominal and pelvic cavities. All right. And on the next slide, I've got a picture. So let's just look at that briefly. All right. So in this picture right here, we're showing the different body cavities, which we've already gone over. So everybody should remember that. So you have here your two lungs, there's your heart, and then here is the abdominal cavity, and then in yellow they're showing the pelvic cavity. And so this area here is going to be where you have your visceral and parietal peritoneum. In the greenish blue color, we've got the visceral and parietal pleura. And then this is the visceral and parietal pericardium. Okay? All right, that was it for part 4 of chapter 1. And we're going to go ahead and stop, and you can start reviewing your chapters 2, 3, and 4 on your own. And then there will be more video lectures that accompany chapter 5 with the histology.